behalf of the family, I want to say thank you, friends, and thank you, family, for letting me be a part of this service. And just want to say we appreciate you so very much for being here to celebrate the life of this sweet lady, Miss Betty Lee Doler. And we're so thankful that you were here. And at this time, we're just going to take this time to remember her life. I did not know Miss Betty personally, but I knew a lot of her family. And I'm thankful for that, but I appreciate you being here. And the Bible says this, the memory of the just is blessed. That means the memory that we have of Miss Betty, you all can carry with you for the rest of your lives, and we can use it, and we can bring back fond memories of that. And I pray that this day would do that. And as we go through this service, we're going to ask God at this time to pray, to bless the service. We're going to have some songs to remember her by. We're also going to have a message here in just a few moments, but I appreciate you, family, and may God comfort you and bless you during this time of loss. You know, it's never easy when a loved one goes to be with the Lord, and I pray that God will give you comfort during this time. This time, let's go to the Lord in prayer, ask Him to touch this service. Dear Lord, we come to you today as humbly as we know how. Father, we thank you so very much for allowing us, Lord, to be here today. God, to celebrate this life of Miss Doler, God, we just pray that you would just touch the proceedings. God, have your hand upon them, Lord, just provide every word that needs to be said to comfort the hearts, Lord, to bring back memories of our loved one and their loved one to them, Lord. I pray that, Lord, this would be not just an honor to her, but an honor to you and to her family. God, I pray that you just take this time and bless it, Lord, that we might, Lord, be better serve, Lord, to do what you'd have us to do. Again, we thank you and we praise you for all that you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
I was thinking as that song was being played, I can only imagine. The Bible gives us a lot of details about what heaven's going to be like, but with our mind, we can't really understand it, comprehend it. So we can only imagine what it's like. But I was thinking right there, man, everything, the very best that I could imagine, doesn't even hold a candle to what it's really like. And I'm thankful for that, and thankful that we can be confident in what heaven's going to be like one day. I want to read the obituary for Miss Doler at this time. Miss Betty Lee Doler, age 81, of Carrollton, passed away Thursday, October the 31st of 2024 in a local hospital. Born on January 14, 1943 on Paris Island, South Carolina, she was the daughter of the late Sidney Upchurch and the late Blanche Gault Upchurch. Living in Ephesus community most of her life, Betty enjoyed spending time with her many friends. Painting and coloring were two of Betty's favorite pastimes, and she was very skilled at velvet art. Later in life, she enjoyed watching television. Her favorite shows were Murder, She Wrote, Walker, Texas Ranger, that's right, that's my kind of TV right there, and Reba, and she could watch these programs over and over. She loved her family and will be dearly missed. Her survivors include her son and daughter-in-law, Ray and Christy Locano of Carrollton, her daughter, Samantha Causey of Alexander City, Alabama, and her nine grandchildren, Blake, Devin, Amy, Leah, Emily, Daniel, Jeremy, Stephanie, and Jenny. Also surviving are her sister, Becky Upchurch, 16 great-grandchildren, and three on the way, with one great-great-grandson, as well as many friends. I'm thankful to read that about her life. You know, I did not know Miss Betty personally. Wish I would have. I didn't realize she lived right here in the community all most of her life. I was a part of this community most of my life as well, but just sometimes fate and life doesn't bring you across paths, but I was thinking about this obituary and how, you know, we all always usually put a lot of importance on the date of birth, on our birthdays, and the date of death. Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, and it is appointed unto man once to die, but after this, the judgment. We put a lot of emphasis on the day we come into this world. That's our birthday. For most of our lives, until we get to a certain age, it's a day that we look forward to. I don't know what that time frame is when we go from looking forward to it to it's just another day. For me, it was about 40. But we put a lot of emphasis on it. We celebrate that day. We look forward to that day. And then the day of our death is also very emphasized. We make a lot of to do about the day that a person passed away. But really, what I was thinking about is what really makes the difference and what really makes all the, where the emphasis should be is not the date that we're born, the date that we die, but the dash in between. See, in that dash, that's really the time that we're alive. That's our life. That's what we do. That's what the legacy we leave behind. That's where the work, the impact takes place, is in that little dash. You know, in my life, I want to be remembered not by the date I was born and the day I died, but by the dash I left in between. And like I said, I didn't know Miss Betty personally, but you guys did. You all knew her. And that dash made an impact on your life. That's why you're here today. That's why you're here to celebrate her. So I know that her dash made an impact. May not have been a global impact, may not have been an impact in our country, but it was an impact on you in some way, shape, or form. So I'm thankful for that. She seemed to make an impact on this little community. There was a lot of a lot of folks that were saddened. Miss Betty had been on our prayer list for quite some time here at the church. Been praying for her. But she, you know, as her obituary read, she was a loving sister, mother, and a friend. And she had good taste, too. I can tell that. She liked Walker, Texas Ranger, and Reba. Amen. If you don't like that, something's wrong with you. Amen. But she had good taste in television. But she made an impact. So I want to leave you with this today as we move on to the next part of the service. What are you doing with the dash in your life? How are you using it to impact somebody else? Are we just surviving and living every day, or are we making an impact, using it to change people and help people and be good to people? Or are we just living it all to ourselves? And like I said, I did not know Miss Betty. I wish I would have. But I got a feeling that she used hers not just for herself, but to help other people and to impact other people. So I give you the encouragement and the challenge today. Take the dash that you have now and use it for an impact, and use it to be a good in this world. And I know God will be pleased with that. This time we're going to have another song, another couple of songs actually. So listen to these songs that her family wanted to play. And then after these songs play, then we'll have a short message.
Tell me, what does it look like in heaven? Is it peaceful? Is it free like they say? Does the sun shine bright forever? Have your fears and your pain gone away? Oh,
Is it peaceful? Is it free like they say?
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light, and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise
of that song, I Will Rise. Thankful to have that hope today, knowing that when he calls my name, I'll meet him in the air. As I said, I did not know Miss Betty personally. I didn't know where she stood with the Lord personally. So I'm not going to stand here and try to preach her into heaven. I'm not going to make any judgments about that because I didn't know. But she knew between her. But I want to share some scripture with you today out of the book of John. If you've been in church any time at all in your life, you probably know this story. It's the story of Lazarus and his death. Lazarus lived with his sisters, Mary and Martha, and they lived in a town called Bethany. And Lazarus got sick one day, and they called for Jesus to come because Jesus was their friend. He was their companion. They knew him, and they knew his power. They believed that he was the Son of God, and they said, if Jesus comes, he can heal him. We've seen him do that before. We've seen him heal people before. But Jesus delayed. And a lot of people would probably have got upset with Jesus, and Mary and Martha may have got their feelings hurt with Jesus because Jesus didn't come right away. But Jesus was going to do something even more powerful than what he had done before. They had seen him heal people. They had seen him raise people up that were crippled, that were blind, to give them their sight back. But they had never seen him raise a person from the dead. And Jesus said, this sickness is not unto death, but unto the glory of God. He said, I'm going to do something through the death of Lazarus that would bring God glory. And when he did that, he delayed 4 days, and as he delayed, Lazarus died. And so many times when we have prayers and we pray for God to do something or answer a prayer, whether it be for a loved one that's sick, and our prayers don't get answered and our loved one dies and goes on, and we wonder why God didn't hear our prayers. I want you to really understand this, and it may not be in this situation, but it may be in a situation to come. God has a purpose for everything that he does, and God didn't make any mistakes. God is perfect and just in all that he does. So he delayed for 4 days. Then he came. Martha found out that he was coming, and she went out to meet him. And she makes this statement in John chapter 11, verse 22, and she says this, "But I know that even now whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it unto thee." She told Jesus, she said, listen, if you'd have been here, my brother would not have died. That's what she said in the previous verse. But she said, but I know this, that whatever you ask God, he'll give it to you. And I want to share 3 little things that I know today. As Martha said, I know some things. There's 3 things I know about a time like this in a person's life. Number one, when somebody that we love dies, it's difficult. I don't care how close you were to Miss Betty, how much you knew, time you spent with her. Her loss is difficult in some way, shape, or form. Any kind of death and loss is difficult. Lazarus was sick, and we're not told if his sickness was prolonged or if it just came about suddenly, but he was sick enough that it took Jesus delayed for 4 days, so we can kind of account that Mary and Martha may have seen, hey, he's really sick, and if Jesus don't come, the doctors can't help him. There's nothing that they can do. So he very well may die. So they may have had some time to prepare their hearts. But even in their preparedness, that loss was still hard. As you can see, Martha was weeping, Mary was weeping, all the Jews around were weeping because loss is hard. And no matter how close you are to somebody, when you lose somebody, it's hard. We never have enough time to prepare. We never have enough time to get our minds right. No matter we think we may, we think we're strong, we think that it's not going to affect us, but we're never ready. We're never ready for somebody that we love to go on. We're never prepared, whether it takes us by suddenness or whether somebody's been sick for a while, we're never prepared. So it's hard. Loss is difficult, and it causes our hearts to be burdened and troubled and all these things. Because there's a lot of things that go along with that, because maybe there were things we wish we'd done different. If we've been prepared, when somebody leaves, there's things we wish we'd have done different. Words we wish we'd have said. Things we wish we would have told them. Things that we would have done for them. Forgiveness that we would have gave to them or asked to receive from them. Whatever the case, it's never easy when you lose somebody. And I know today that it's hard knowing that Miss Betty's gone. And no matter what she was to you in your life, there's a time of hardness. But I'm thankful for what the Bible says this. They knew that when Jesus came, it was going to get better. They said, Jesus is here now. I don't know what he's going to do, but I know it's just better. And I'm going to tell you this, whenever you lose something or lose somebody, if you put Jesus right in the middle of it, he'll make it better. He may not take it away, but he'll make it better. He said this in John chapter 14 and verse 26. He talks about a comforter. John chapter 14. He says, I go away from you. He says, but the comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, who the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring you into the remembrance of whatsoever I have said unto you. He says, if I go, then I'll send somebody, and that's a comforter. I'm glad that we have comfort in the Holy Spirit today. Number two, not only is it hard, but I know this today, that there's hope. There's hope. Jesus had the power to comfort them. Jesus had the power to do anything he wanted to do. And he's about, I don't want to spoil this story for you, but he's about to call him from the dead. But they had no idea what Jesus was going to do. But there was hope when he got there. He asked them this. They said, where have you laid him? They said, where's he at? They said, well, we didn't put him in the grave. Jesus, there's not a whole lot we can do. You probably don't even need to go there. He's been dead 4 days. He's probably going to stink. And Jesus said, just show me where you laid him. Because he was moved with compassion. And when Jesus shows up, there's always hope. And listen, there's hope in anything. When God does something in our stories or in the midst of things, just because something goes the way that we didn't want it to go, it doesn't mean that there's no hope. He said, where have you laid him? They went, took him to the grave, and he made this statement, and he says, Lazarus, come forth. Have you ever noticed he had to say Lazarus? He had to say that because if he just said, come forth, everybody that was dead would have got up and came out of the grave. But he called him by name, and he said, Lazarus, come forth. Listen, I want you to know something. That is not something that God will do in this day and time, okay? Our loved one, as much as we love them, we can call on God, but he's not going to bring them back from the dead. And can I tell you this? Your loved one, if they're in heaven, they wouldn't come back to this place for anything. They're in the perfect place. We wouldn't ask them to come back. So God doesn't raise people from the dead in this sense now, but I want to tell you what the Bible does tell us. He doesn't raise us from the dead in this sense, but one day, the Bible says that he is going to raise some folks up. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13, it says this. Paul's writing this. He said, I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. He says, if we know Jesus, we have hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus, God will bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we be with the Lord, forever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. What I just read you there was this. God didn't call people out of the grave like he called Lazarus now, but one of these days, Jesus is coming back. And not only is he going to come, he's not going to have to just call us by name. He's going to make a shout on that horn, on that trumpet, and everybody in the grave is going to get up. Everybody that knew him, that were blood-bought, they're going to get up just like Lazarus did. And listen, because of that, we can have hope. He says, I tell you these things that you saw are not as others that have no hope. I'm glad I got hope in Jesus today. I hope that you have that. This is, of course, let me say this. This is only promised to those that know the hope of salvation in Jesus Christ. So there's hardness, there's hope, But I want you to know there's also a future. Last thing, and I'll be done. The Bible says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are all men most miserable. That means if this is all we got to look forward to, this earth, Brother Ray, if all that we get in this earth, if this is all we got to look forward to, we're in bad shape. We're in bad shape because this earth don't have a whole lot, Mr. Matthew, this earth and this life don't have a whole lot to make us look forward to. You know what I liked about when I was a kid? I always had something to look forward to. Summer was coming. We could go to the beach, or winter time was coming. I could anticipate snow. I always looked forward to something. And, you know, I found out as I got older, those things don't make me happy anymore. So there's not a whole lot to look forward to as an adult. But as a Christian, I got something to look forward to because this is not our home and this is not the hope that we live for. This is not the future that we're living for. This is just a little bit. This Bible says this in Job chapter 14, verse 1. Man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. That means this world is pretty much all it has is trouble for us in one way, shape, or form. But the child of God, there's so much more to look forward to in the future. Let me read it to you real quick and I'll be done. Revelation chapter 21. God has came back. He's called his people home. Now he's made a new heaven and a new earth. And this is what it says about it in Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears. Man, praise the Lord for that. Aren't you glad there won't be no sadness there, no sorrow, no tears, no crying? There shall be no more death. Praise the Lord, we won't never have to do this again when we get there. There'll be no more death. Neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. Praise the Lord for that. I'm talking, that's not just physical pain, that's spiritual pain, that's mental pain, that's emotional pain. There's no pain there. For the former things are passed away. And he sat upon the throne, and he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. I don't know about you, but that tells me I got something to look forward to. That's heaven. He's going to make all things new. John 14, 1 says, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will return again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That's something to look forward to today, and I'm thankful for that. That's a future I hope everybody in this room is prepared for. But I can't leave you without telling you the truth about this matter. Only those people that are the children of God will enter that place I just read about in Revelation chapter 21. Only those that place their faith in Jesus Christ can receive the gift of grace. And it is a gift. The Bible says in this in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, that God, the Lord, is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us. We're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That means he wants everybody to be saved, be able to take place in this future that I'm talking about. So, preacher, how do I do that? Romans chapter 10 tells us all that we need to know. He says this, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How? Verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God had raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. That's how you get saved. And that's how you know that you're going to heaven and you got that hope and that future that I just talked to you about today. Again, like I said, I did not know Miss Betty personally. I wish I did. I wish I had more to say about her today. But I tell you this, if she knew the Lord, I know I know the Lord. One of these days, we got an eternity to live together, amen? And I'll get to know her and she'll get to know me. And I praise the Lord for that. And I pray that you will have that same confidence. I read to you in 1 Thessalonians how he's going to come back pretty soon. All the signs point to it being very, very soon. So don't wait around. Don't procrastinate about it. If you don't know Jesus, I pray that maybe today, maybe I've said something that may have you deciding that you need to ask some questions about that. Please see me before you leave. I'll share with you what the Bible says about salvation. It's a gift, and he wants everybody to have it. I praise God for this time here today. Family, thank you for letting me be here. And I want to pray, and then we're going to have another song. I'm going to come back up and read a poem the family wants read, and then we'll be dismissed in just a moment. Let's pray. Lord, I love you today. I thank you, Lord, for the words that you allowed us to say. God, the anointing that you gave me to write them down with. Lord, there's many things that I know, but I know that you are the Lord, and Lord, that you died for our sins. And I pray if there's anyone here under the sound of my voice that don't know Jesus, God, I pray that something is said in a song or in a message, God, would penetrate that heart, cause them to come to you into repentance. God, I pray for comfort for Brother Ray and his family and Sister Samantha, her family. God, I pray that you just give them what they stand in need of in this day. And we'll give you the honor and the glory for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven from the hands that hold you now. There's not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me.
until I'm standing with you in the sun. I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run until I finally see what you can see. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now.
And I got a poem here I want to read. It says, I made it home. I just wanted to let you know that I made it home. The journey wasn't an easy one, but it didn't take too long. Everything is so pretty here, so white, so fresh, so new. I wish that you could close your eyes so you could see it here too. Please try not to be sad for me. Try to understand. God is taking care of me. I'm in the shelter of His hands. Here there is no sadness and no sorrow and no pain. Here there is no crying and I'll never hurt again. Here it is so peaceful when all the angels sing. I really have to go now, for I've just got to try my new wings. Amen. Praise the Lord for that. I appreciate you so much for being here. Again, I know it means so much to this family. It means so much to this church. Thank you for letting us be of assistance to you, Brother Ray. I do want to say this. I don't want anybody to leave. Our church ladies have prepared some refreshments in the back, some foods and refreshments for you, so please come back. And that's a ministry that we do with our church, so I don't want you to leave. I want you to come back and have some time that you can gather together. I know Brother Ray said it's been a while since some of you have seen each other very much, so you can have some time of fellowship, take all the time that you need, but please come back and be a part of that with us today. And again, thank you for being here on behalf of the family. And family, if there's anything I can do to help you, I can never be of assistance to you in any way. If this church can ever help you in any way, you reach out and let us know. We're going to have a word of prayer, and then Ms. Nicole is going to play Amazing Grace, and after that song is over, we'll be dismissed. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this day, for this family, for this life. Lord, we just thank you for all that you've done in this place, and Lord, just pray that you continue to move in our hearts this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yeah.
stand in need of. God bless the food, bless the fellowship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.